Thank you very much. Good evening to you all out there, our dear listeners. This is another Monday, a special one, because it is marking the end of the ninth month. Today is the 27th day. I think the 28th September. And so next Monday will enter another month. That's what I meant. The last four, the month. And as usual, we have met here to discuss things which are very dear to my heart. For today, I have the paper which our BEC candidates wrote. So we're going to begin, you know, reviewing them, so that those of you who will be listening, you might probably see what you were able to do whilst people were outside probably praying for you. This is not to say that I am marking the paper, no. I am going to walk through this just like any other person would do. But the final say is with our examiners. As usual, I think we'll have to begin with the multiple choice questions. So if you are listening to me and you are a candidate, this time you have finished, you have completed a thing, and I think your pen is even thrown somewhere. But I'm just here to remind you of what you did. Those of you who didn't like to know of it, yes, you just assume that you didn't write it. So the paper actually started with a section B or paper 2. But we are going to begin with paper 1 as a way of warming up before we get into the game. All those listening who are teachers of mathematics and parents who really have some stake in the mathematics paper, this is an opportunity for you to just pay attention. You may have to tell your ward to bring the question paper so that you can also sit around and then listen as we discuss. The instruction that was given for the paper 1 says answer all questions. That each question is followed by 4 options labeled A to D. Find the correct option for each question and shade in pencil on your answer sheet the answer space which bears the same letter as the option you have chosen. Give only one answer to each question. An example is given below. That, as usual, you will read it as, if 3n plus 2 is equals to 8, find the value of n. But mathematically, this should be read as, when 2 is added to 3 times a certain number, the result is 8. When 2 is added to 3 times a certain number n, the result is 8. Find the value of n. As usual, you will bear me out that the answer was the D option. I have a problem with this, but we have to go. The examples were giving the options A to E. Meanwhile, the whole paper, we have options A to D, and we have been informed from the very first sentence. So I'll ask WAEC to be careful here, because it's likely to confuse some of the candidates. But WAEC is not listening to me. Well, I think we can just cross the carpet. We only have to pick a number and call somebody. Examples are what students usually follow. So if the example is not the right thing, and then is it becomes a source of confusion. Anyway, let's go ahead. Then says, think carefully before you shade the answer spaces. Erase completely any answers you wish to change. Then a very important instruction here says, do all rough work on this question paper. Now answer the following questions. The very first question, as question one, is based on operations on fractions. Operations on fractions. The question is asking us to simplify 3/4 minus 1/3 plus 1/12. Simplify 3/4, not 3 over 4, minus 1 over 3, plus 1 over 12. No. It's supposed to be read, simplify 3/4 minus 1/3 plus 1/12. Ladies and gentlemen, if you look at this question, you really see that the denominators are all positive factors of 12. So you just have to write equivalent fractions of this given fraction so that the denominators will be 12. So our 3/4 can be written as 9/12. So minus 1/3 will be written as 4/12. And then we have plus 1/12. So just moving from the left to the right, when you meet such situations involving subtraction and addition, you don't have to think about board mass. You can just start from the left to right and then go ahead with that. So 9/12 minus 4/12 will give us 5/12. Then we have plus 1/12. And that gives us 6/12, which of course is the same as 1/2. So the answer, the result is 1/2, which is the B option. In effect, the original question 3/4 minus 1/3 plus 1/12 will give us 1/2. You don't have to worry. You could have also added 3/4 and 1/12, which will actually become 9/12 plus 1/12, and so that one will be 10/12. And then you subtract the 4/12, which is coming from the 1/3. And of course, 10/12 minus 4/12 will give you 6/12, which is just like the same thing we had. And then you simplify the 6/12 to have 1/2. In any case, the result is the same. The B option is what I'll go for. And this candidate actually chose the B option. So bravo to whoever worked this problem. Question number two reads, given that W is the set of all X such that X is a factor of 18 and M is equal to the set X such that X is a multiple of 12. Find M intersection N, or find N intersection M. In any case, it is commutative, so it's okay. So the first one says N is the set of all X such that X is a factor of 12. And then M is equal to the set of X, the set X such that X is a multiple of 12. This is a good question, but a bad one. Find N intersection M. A very nice one. Let's start with set N, which is factors of 18. Of course, I think they wanted to say positive factors of 18. Because when we talk about factors of 18, there are some negative numbers which are also factors. These are some of the things that we have been talking about and that we need to. The best they could have also said was that we're looking for the, let's say, counting factors of eight in which are counting numbers. Then it means we know we are dealing with the positive ones. Anyway, so what I want to think as they were thinking. So the positive factors of 18 will be 1, 2, 3, 6, 9, and 18. So the set N will be equals to 1, the members of N will be 1, 2, 3, 6, 9, and 18. It has the positive factors of 18. And we're looking for M, which are supposed to be multiples of that X, is supposed to be a multiple of 12. If we are thinking about the positive multiples of 12, then it will begin with 12, 24, 36, 48, and so on. This is an example of an infinite set. If we are to look for the intersection of these two sets, ladies and gentlemen, the guy, I think he didn't do it, but it's actually D, which is the null set or empty set, because there's no common member. There's no number here, any member which is common to both N and M. A was given as 1, 2, 3, and 6, which is not the correct response. B, 1, 2, 3, 6, 12, which is not appropriate. C is 2, 3, 6, 12, and 18, which is far away. And then D is the empty set. And I'll go for D, the option D. So if you are listening as a candidate, or I'll say past candidate, the first two options, number one was B, which is 1/2. Number two is D, which is empty set or the null set. We are asked to, for that question number three, to express a certain number here in standard form. We are to write a number here in standard form. So, I think at this point, I would like to invite anybody who is listening and has the paper to read the question 3 for us. The Activator Studio line is 0503923158. Let's make it a bit interactive so that if you are listening to me and you have the question paper, 2020, as you call it, BCE mathematics paper, question number 3, I will be very glad if you can read the question for us. If nobody does it, I will be compelled to do that. I'll probably call somebody right there to read it for us. It's not any difficult task, but I just want to have a different voice. Okay, to read a question for us. Are we going to have anybody to do that? We are to express a certain number here in standard form. So I think I'm going to get somebody to do that for us. Because the program says, let's talk mathematics, so I don't have to do the talking all by myself. Yeah, a gentleman is coming to help us. So, we move together. Question number 3 reads...
Question number 3. Express 4382.93 in standard form.
0.9 what?
3.
Please, next time, read this one. That's the reason why I actually called somebody. We don't read the number as if we are with a lotto forecasters, okay? It's supposed to be read as 4,000, 4,382 and 9,300. But you read, people will read this one as 4,382.93. It's okay. Let's learn to read this well. If we are to write this in standard form, of course, we're going to get, I am reading it the way you want to read it. I'll read it as 4.38293 × 10^3, which of course is going to be the D option. The D option. A was written as 4 × 10^4, which is not appropriate. Then the second one, the way they have even written it, if you don't take care, they wrote this one as 43 point something, but writing numbers in standard form, we have to write in such a way that the point is between the first two significant figures. And so the D option is the appropriate choice. D. Okay. Now we are going to do the fourth one. Again, if you are having the paper, this time strictly, anybody who has the paper and is listening, if you can read the fourth question for us. It's very interesting. Anytime we are teaching mathematics to any group of people, especially now that we have the new curriculum thinking about four strands, number, algebra, then we have geometry, and then data. This question is or falls within the first strand, that is number, properties of numbers and operations. So it says, which property of arithmetic is used in, then we have A, and a bracket open, A into bracket as you read it, X plus Y is equal to AX plus AY. You are not to solve this. They have solved it for you. And they want you to tell which property has been used. So I'll take it. Which property of arithmetic is used in A into bracket X plus Y is equal to AX plus AY. I'm reading it the way you will understand it. Otherwise, I was going to read it differently. But let's go the way you want to go. And ladies and gentlemen, the options are A, associative, B, commutative, D, distributive, and C is distributive, and then D, initiative. Of course, if you are very smart, you know that initiative has nothing to do with whatever properties we are talking about. To be straightforward, I think the option that satisfies the question is the C option, because when we have A into bracket X plus Y and it's written at AX plus AY, we are distributing the A, which is multiplication, is multiplying what we have inside here, X plus Y. So multiplication is being distributed over addition. So the response, the option is C. So question 4 is C. Now, a very interesting question, and if you don't take care, such questions usually confuse people who are not ready to get it right. And I read it. Now, we have subtract 7x minus 3, which is in bracket, subtract this from, subtract 7x minus 3 from 5 minus 3x. 5 minus 3x. And then it's the second one. Okay, so let me read it. Subtract 7x minus 3 from 5 minus 3x. So it means it's supposed to be 5 minus 3x minus 7x minus 3. So if I write my 5 minus 3x, then I subtract. I have to be smart. Make sure that you use the bracket very, very critically, otherwise you get it wrong. So 5 minus 3x, if you like, put it in bracket, minus, then open a bracket and close. Now go and write your 7x minus 3. So when I start removing the bracket, I'll write it at 5 minus 3x minus 7x plus 3. So in effect, you're going to have it as 5 minus 3x minus 7x plus 3. So the 5 plus 3 will be 8, because these are numbers without variables. And a negative 3x minus 7x will be minus or negative 10x. So we are going to have it as 8 minus 10x. And these people, you know, because of the way they wrote, if you don't take care and then you go and write it as 10x minus 8, which is A, that is wrong. Then we have 4x minus 8b, that is also not perfect. But my choice is 8 minus 10x, and again, that is C. The D, which is 2 minus 10x, is not appropriate. If you don't take care, you might think, you are, as you keep the bracket, you have 5 minus the 3 to think it is 2. And so, be very careful with such questions. Ladies and gentlemen, so far, we have finished with the fifth question. And the options we had were number 1, B. Number 2, D. Number 3 is D. Number 4, C. And number 5, C. So, if you have your question paper, just let's mark it as you go ahead. Unless, of course, you don't trust what I'm doing. All right, but you have the right not to agree. Then we come to question number 6. Question number 6 reads: the cost of 12 notebooks is 54 CDs, 84 pesos. The cost of 12 notebooks is 54 CDs, 84 pesos. Find the cost of one notebook. Ladies and gentlemen, the only mathematics you are doing here is division. That the operation you have to use is division. And that you are to divide the 54 CDs, 84 pesos by 12. Just find out how many groups of 12 we have in 54. And I think that will give you 6. No, it is not 6. It is rather 4. Because 12 times 4 will be 48. So you write your 4. Write a 48 under the 54. And you have a remainder of 6. So you have 6 small CDs. You want to change it as if it is pesos. To have 684 pesos, just push it there. Now 68 is what comes into focus. You have 4 CDs. You go into the personal side. Now, 68. How many groups of 12 do you have in 68? That is actually 5. And that will give you 60. Because 12 times 5 is 60. You now have 8. And then you pull down the 4. You now have 84. You ask yourself, how many groups of 12 do you have in 84? And that is 7. So, what it means is that one notebook will cost 4 CDs. 57 pesos. Again, that one is option C. Hey, these people like C. Number 6. The first option, A, is 5 CDs, 57 pesos, not appropriate. Because the 54 you have there is not up to 60. If it were up to 60 and above, then 12 would divide 60 to give you 5. But this one is 54. So a number below that is what we like. And so A, 5 CDs, 57 pesos is not correct. B, 4 CDs, 67 pesos. They are confusing you here. It's not appropriate. C, 4 CDs, 57 pesos, my choice. And D, 3 CDs, 57 pesos, which I don't go for. Alright. So far we have done 6. And I'm not asking you to mark yourself because you may decide to. We have 40 multiple choice questions and we have finished 6. Ask yourself, if you were a candidate, how many have you had so far? Number 6. The option, the correct option is C. We've said that already. Number 7 is talking about inequalities. You have a number line here with the numbers written there. Even though this is a number line, it didn't show the arrows. Okay, I'll not go for it. But it's okay, that's what you are given. We have negative 3 to 3 as the range we have here. And then what we have a bar on it with an open instant from on negative 2. Then on 2 we have a darkened dot. So they want you to actually read this. And of course, then what it is that you have a number negative 2 not to be included because we have an open circle on it, which means we are going for numbers between that number. We're talking about integers. Move between negative 2 but up to the 2 because they're on the 2, the dot is darkened. So the responses we have here, the options is negative 2 is greater than y and y is greater than 2. Not appropriate because here that is not correct anyway. Then B, negative 2 is less than or equal to y and y is less than 2. That is not appropriate, but I'm sure some people will pick it. Of course, if it was the negative 2 which had a darkened spot and the 2 with the open circle, that was going to be the correct response. But here, no. Let's go to C. It says negative 2 is greater than or equal to y and y is greater than 2. That is not perfect. The expression here is not supposed to be. Once you have the numbers starting from the negative 2 and going to 2, you really have to use the less than, and not. And so we have the D option now, which is my choice. It's negative 2 is less than y, and y is less than or equal to 2. That is the perfect response. So number 7. The best option is D. The best option is D. Then we come to question number 8, which is based on indices. We are to simplify. So please listen carefully to this. We have 2ab squared. The square of, listen carefully, the square of 2ab squared multiplied by 3a to the exponent 3b, or simply the square of 2ab squared times 3a cubed b, and we are to simplify. Just have to write it as one single term. So we're going to do some kind of multiplication. The best you can do is try to simplify what you have in the bracket first. We have 2ab squared in bracket, and then this whole thing is squared. So what I will do is I'll write it separately. So I'll have 4a squared b to the exponent 4. So I've undone the bracket. Then I'm multiplying this by 3a cubed b. So I'm now going to take it straight away. So the 4 will multiply the 3 to give me 12. A squared multiplying a cubed will be a to the exponent 5. B to the exponent 4 multiplying b will be b to the exponent 5. So in effect, we have 12 a to the exponent 5, b to the exponent 5. Now, the options we have here, we have 6 a to the exponent 4, b to the exponent 5. If you don't take care, you are going to pick this because people who will not expand the what you have in the bracket first will think that we have a 2 multiplying the 3 to give you 6. You are deceiving yourself when you do that. So A is not the correct option. B, we have 12 a cubed b to the exponent 4, also not appropriate. C, we have 12 a to the exponent 6 b to the exponent 4, nope. And then D is 12 a to the exponent 5 b to the exponent 5, which is my choice. So ladies and gentlemen, I know there's something here. Some people, the 4 times 3 will give you 12, all right. The a squared times a cubed, some people might think that you have to multiply the 2 by 3 to get 6. No. And so they'll go for C. This is not correct. The correct option is D. So far, we have finished with questions 1 to 8. Nobody has called to tell us anything, and so I am going to probably pause when we get to question number 10, and then we'll try to pick one of the paper 2 questions. So we go for 10, and then we pick one question in section 2. The next time we continue. That is what I want to do. But if you have a different view, then you got to call me and say, no, why don't you finish the paper 1 up to anywhere time will allow us? Then the next time we continue. It is a choice that you have to make. Probably just to get you come on board and tell us something. So questions 1 to 8 are done. And then we are going to look at question number 9. It says, which of the following polygons does not have a line of symmetry? Which of the following polygons does not have a line of symmetry? And we have A, kite. B, isosceles triangle. C, trapezium. And D, rhombus. Ladies and gentlemen, what do you think will be your choice? I'm floating this also. And listening to what people have, your views are also supposed to be respected. I'll go over the question and the options. Which of the following polygons does not have a line of symmetry? You know, when we talk about line of symmetry, I didn't say symmetry anyway. A line of symmetry is that line which will split a shape into two equal halves, such that if it is possible, we can fold one half and it will fall on the other exactly. That is a line of symmetry. And so the options here, I was going for one, but I want to listening to you first. If nobody calls, well, just as you have been doing it, we'll go all out to say it. But it is very important for us to probably have somebody's voice heard. So at this point, I will be glad if we can get anyone, a student, a teacher, a parent, a passerby, could be anybody. And for that, we'll read the question again and go through the options. The last time, if nobody comes on board, I'll tell you my peace of mind. Which of the following polygons does not have a line of symmetry? A. Kite. B. Isosceles triangle. C. Trapezium. D. Rhombus. If you know how these shapes look like, you should be able to tell which of them does not have a line of symmetry. Am I to wait or just go ahead to tell? Is anybody coming to support us? Are we lucky to have anyone? All right, I'll go for C. By the nature of a trapezium, it is not likely to have a line of symmetry. The rhombus here, some people might think that rhombus, but then a square is a rhombus. And don't forget that if the rhombus you're talking about is a square, then of course it even has four lines of symmetry. And don't forget that all squares are rhombuses, but not all rhombuses are squares anyway. All right, so that is it. Question number 10. Which is an application of percents. So let's have it. Says a trader sold a radio set for 72 Ghana cedis, making a profit of 8%. Find correct to the nearest Ghana cedi the cost price of the radio set. These are two in one question. First, you have to know how to work out the percent part. And then when you finish two, you have to know what it means when we say correct to the nearest something. All right, so we are going to go ahead. I don't know if anybody would like to take this one. You're just making it as if I'm the guy doing the wallet walasa. You see, that's not fair. So if you are ready, come on board. Anybody who comes tomorrow, you can meet me and then take one CD for a credit. Anyway, but let's go ahead. The question is very explicitly clear, telling us that somebody sells a radio set for 72 Ghana cedis and then wins a profit or gains 8%. Find correct to the nearest Ghana cedi the cost price of the radio set. I know that many people, I'm talking about my candidates, many might make a mistake here. I don't forget that because the selling price is what is given. And after selling the radio set for 72 CDs, we have a profit of 8 CDs. It means the selling price is actually, in terms of percent, is 108%. And that corresponds to 72 CDs. So what they want you to do is that if 108% gives us 72 Ghana CDs, then what will 100% be? Because the cost price is always going to be 100%. So you are looking for 100%. as a fraction of 108%. So the 108 will be your denominator, the 100% becomes your numerator, and then you multiply that by 72. Alright, so guys, ladies and gentlemen, what do? We're going ahead to divide. I know that 12 will divide 108 9 times. And 12 will divide 72 6 times. 6 is divided by 3 to give you 2. And 9 is divided by 3. We have 3 groups of 3 in 9. So 3 down here. So in effect, we have 100 times 2 as the numerator. And then this is being divided by 3. I know that it is going to be 66.6666%. But then we are told to write this in the nearest city. So 66.66, of course, 66 pesos is very close to one city than zero. So we'll just write this as 67 Ghana cedis. So the answer is going to be 67 Ghana cedis. A is given, and the A option is 66 Ghana cedis, which is not correct. B, 67 Ghana cedis, my choice. C, 77 Ghana cedis, no. D, 78 Ghana cedis, not really. So the right response, the option is B. It's B. So that is it. We have worked up to question 10. I said I was going to stop at 10 and then consider the questions in paper 2. If this is what we all want, let's have somebody to confirm. If we still have to go on to do what we are doing, I'll still need some remarks from someone. So I'm going to pause a little bit and then wait for you, your comment, your views about this. Good. So I am waiting for your response. To get right here, please, the activated studio line is 0503-923158. 0503-923158. You may have to, send messages also through the same line if you want. Could be a WhatsApp message. But it is very important for us to, just interact directly. If you want me to go ahead with the multiple choice questions, that's fine. I'll be glad to do that because we have some, if I'm not mistaken, this is about 19 minutes or roughly, no, it's less than that anyway. It's just about 14 minutes to go. So what we'll probably have to do is continue with the multiple choice. Wherever we get to, we stop it. Next week, all things being equal, our creator giving us the opportunity again, we'll continue from there. So then, let me just go quickly over the options we have decided as the right responses, so you can check. Number one, the option was B. Number two, D, as in Daniel. Number three, we went for D, still Daniel. Number four was C, distributive property. Number five was C. Number six, I think your guess is as well. We had it. And what did we go for? It was still the C. Number 7 was D. Number 8, D. Number 9 we went for C, and number 10 is B, as in Bedu or Brahma or Bole. All right, number 11. Vera is 11 years old, and her brother is 9 years old. They shared 60 oranges in the ratio of their ages. How many more oranges does Vera get? Ladies and gentlemen, this is a very interesting question, and I believe you're going to pay attention to listen. Vera is 11 years old, and her brother is 9 years old. If they are sharing 60 oranges in the ratio of their ages, how many more oranges does Vera get? So the ratio is 11:9. When we are starting, 11 for Vera, 9 for the brother. And then they are sharing 60 oranges. Don't forget that the 60 oranges is the total number of oranges. So what we have to do is just go for the total ratio, which is going to be 20. If 20 is going for 60, then it means 1 will go for 3. So it means you just have to multiply the 11 by 3 to give you 33, and the 9 by 3 to make it 27. So Vera will actually have 33 oranges, and the brother will have 27. So how many more? You just have to subtract, and 33 minus 27 is 6. So A, 6, that's the correct. B, they say 27. You see how they do things. If you don't take care, you'll go for the 27, which is for the brother. But the question is asking how many more. And then C is 34 and D is 39. So the best option is A. All right. But then what you could also do was you can make it 11 divided by the 20 times 60 for Vera, and then 9 divided by 20 times 60 for the brother. In any case, you have the same thing. The 20 will divide the 60 to give you 3. Multiply this by 11, 33. You come to the other one. 20 dividing 60 will be 3 times the 9 is 27. So whichever way, multiple choice. So the way you will do it, to at times you don't even have to put any pen or pencil down to do such things. All right, so that was it. Number 11, the option, the best option is A. Then we come to question number 12, which is reading the square of x minus 3. Of course, this is written as x minus 3 into bracket, then you square it. This is read x. Don't read x minus 3 squared. No. It might mean as if it is only the 3 that is squared. So the square of x minus 3 is equal to 16. And they want you to find what x is. Of course, you can easily see that x is 7, but let's go ahead. You see, if you have the square of x minus 3 to be equal to 16, all you need to do is straight away find the square root of each side. So you find the square root of the square of x minus 3, it will just be x minus 3, and this is going to be equal to 4, because the square root of 16 is 4. So you have, when 3 is subtracted from a certain number, the result is 4. What is that number? All you do is that once the 3 is being subtracted, just add 3 to each side. So we end up getting x is equals to 4 plus 3, which is 7. So again, question 12. The options are A, 1, B, 3, C, 4, D, 7. And I'll go for the 7. This is the best option. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Radio Windy Bay 98.3 MHz. The program is Let's Talk Mathematics. What we are doing right now is going through the BEC Mathematics Past Question, the current one, 2020. We have worked through up to question 12. Let's look at question 13. It says, find, a very tricky question. I think the person did not get it, but it's okay. I'm not discouraging you from listening. It says, find the image of the point -2, 3 under a reflection in the X axis. -2, 3. Oh, all it should be is, it's supposed to be -2, -3. Let's go for it. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll read it again. Find the image of the point -2, 3 under a reflection in the X axis. If my eyes are not deceiving me. For this paper, I think it was too faint, but I don't know. All right, so if this is the correct thing, then if you have a point -2, 3, you plot it -2, 3, and then you want to find the image of this using the x-axis as the mirror, ladies and gentlemen, I think the correct response is supposed to be -2, -3. But there is no answer here like that, because the options I have here, we have A, 2, -3, which is not correct. B, -3, 2, we are not changing anything. It's reflection, the numbers do not have to change. C, 2, 3, which is not appropriate. D, 3, 2. So none of this, according to me, should be correct. And you can go and check. When we find where the point is -2, 3, this point, and then you want to reflect it using the X axis, of course, the -2, 3 will be in the second quadrant. If you draw your axis, the two perpendicular axes, the top, right, no, it will be in the second top, okay? And then you are reflecting it using the X axis, so it will just come down. So if you know what I'm talking about, the quadrant very well, it will be in the third quadrant. And in the third quadrant, both X and Y are negative. One principle of reflection is that wherever the point is, the image will be the same distance, but in the opposite direction. That's a very nice principle for reflection. So I don't know whether why I could make this one a bonus. It's not. Anyway, then we are going to have another question. I think I will need somebody to read for me, so at least we change the dynamics a little bit. If we can have somebody to read for us, it's a very straightforward one. Say, what fraction of 3 weeks is something? So, what fraction of 3 weeks is 18 days? Of course, it's obvious. What fraction of 3 weeks is 18 days? So, the 18 days is what we are looking at as our numerator. And then 3 weeks, if we are going for not the Ghanaian type, which is Nawotrio. 3 weeks is 3 weeks, 21 days. So 18 as a fraction of 20 one days, I just have to think about what number is going to divide both 18 and 21. And the choice is 3. How many groups of 3 do we have in 18? That is 6. And then 21 is 7. So it's going to be 6 sevenths. And for this one, the person chose, you see the problem we have. Because the person thought 3 days of 18 days, 3 weeks, no? Instead of the 3 weeks being the what has been given and you are finding 18 days, the person probably wrote it at 3 divided by 18. So you have 1/6. And I'll say no. B, 6/7, correct for 1 point. C, 1/7, not appropriate. D, 9/11, that is also not good. You see, what the person did here tells me that he was seeing 18 days as what we are looking as our whole, and then you are finding 3 weeks as a fraction. No. The question says, what fraction of 3 weeks? So the 3 weeks is the main thing. And then, because we have weeks and days, you have to change the weeks to days so that the 18 days and the 3 weeks will have the same denomination. So whoever chose this one, I'll say for this one, dear, I'm fat. All right. So we go to question number 15, which I think will be the last one, but the signal I'm getting tells me that I think we have exhausted our time. So 2 minutes, we'll take the last question. It says, what is the median of the following numbers? And the numbers are 4, 16, 13, 18, 3, 20, 6, 7, 15, 2, 10 and 12. Ladies and gentlemen, what we have to do here is to arrange these numbers, probably from the smallest to the largest, or the largest to the smallest, and pick the middle one. So I'm going to do the arrangement, but I'll call the numbers again. 4, 16, 13, 18, 3, 26, 7, 15, 2, 10, 12. So our 2 will come first, followed by 3, followed by 4. There is no 5, so we go for 6. We have a 7, we pick it. There is no 8, no 9, so we go to 10. I don't think we have a 11, so we have 12. Lucky to have 13, so we are writing it. No 14, but we have 15. We have 16, so we write it. I am not seeing any 17, but we have 18. We don't have any 19, but we have 20. Yes, we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Because there are 12 data points, and 12 is an even number, it means we have to find the lower half and the upper half. And as even number of items, you pick the two middle ones, which I'm seeing as 10 and 12. So the lower half will be 2, 3, 4, 6, and 7. We draw a line there, a line segment. Then starting from 20, 20, 18, 16, 15, 30, 13, we also have 5. So the two middle numbers, which is 10 and 12, some people will say add the 10 and 12 and divide by 2, but that is waste of time. The 12 is 2 more than the 10, so take 1 from the 12 to get 11, drop the 1 onto the 10 and get 11, meaning the median is going to be 11. So the options, A, 7, not correct. B, 10, not appropriate. C is 11, that's perfect. D, 12, don't go for it. You see, they brought a 10, 11, and 12. If you don't know what you are doing, you might be confused. But you see, because the number of items is 12 and it's even, you split to say that you have 5 down, 5 up. The two middle numbers were 10 and 12. The mean of this is 11. So ladies and gentlemen, this is where time will allow us to go. And I'm saying that the questions were actually manageable. And for now, what I'll say is that so next week, same time, we'll say, you dear listeners, have a very good time. Bye for now. Radio.